Evening, everyone. Welcome to Officer 24/7. My name is Niharika Walia Bhatnagar, and I am with you with the area of JIIB. Acha, now we're talking about AFM. The series is going on, but before I set further my class, there is a very, very important announcement, everyone. Regarding that announcement, the most important thing is please share our session. These sessions are super important that I'm taking up. I am taking up various classes. I am taking up the various series. Over the period of time, I've collected a good number of questions for the JIIB. The new syllabus as well, right? The old syllabus is already covered a lot. So, first request is please share this session. And now let me show you what exactly I wanted to tell you. So, if you haven't shared or liked this session, first of all, please share it and like it. The most important thing that I'm going to let you know today is we are offering you sabse saste 5 din. What does it mean? You are getting 5 days, which are at this point of time, this is by far the lowest price I've ever seen ever since I've joined ADDA, right? I've been associated with the area of JIIB from quite a long time now. But now we are not coming up no more with that 81% sale. Right now, if you can see it on the website, obviously everybody waits that at one point of time, I should buy the courses, right? It is something which affects anybody, that what is the price that I should pay. What if I tell you at this point of time, the price that you're going to get is the lowest ever? You're looking forward towards JIIB and CIIB? Go on to this area. Go on to the area of buy now. Use the code Y541. If you're using the company code, you get around 82%. If you're using the code Y541, you will get a discount. You will get a discount of 84%. Till now, all I could give you through my code was 81%. Right now you can get up to 85%, and that too, this is not the limit. If you are using our website, then it is 84%. And what if you are not using our website? If you are using our app, then it can go up to an amount of 85%. Additional 1% discount is available if you are using the app. So that means you can buy it at less than 9500, right? 9598 at least. If you add 1% more, probably 100 rupees at least would be going down. So technically you will get entire JIIB, entire CIIB. That means you don't even have to pay a single penny after you have got this for the next 2 years, everyone. And then probably if I talk about the average is 10,000, roughly 10,000 for 2 years. That means per year it is less than 5,000, you know. So it's around 5,000. Think about every single month, how much money are you paying? 500, 600, and that's it. So overall, if I look at this particular scenario, this is what I was talking about. Sabse saste 5 din. So if you haven't taken up our courses yet, then kindly go ahead and punch it right away. Go ahead and enroll in the courses, because this price drop will never come again. Right, so till now though, there is only one point, that this is by far the lowest that is coming up. So please go ahead and enroll yourself in these particular courses in these 5 days itself, because if you buy it at the lowest price right now, after this the price might rise again. Then again, the sale is definitely ending soon, so if you want to buy, then go ahead and buy as early as possible. So this is the most important announcement. So I hope this particular session will be definitely important, and at the same time, you will be able to enroll yourself in time, right? Acha, now let's begin with the session as well, everyone. I've talked about the most important thing for the day. Now coming back to our topic that we were discussing today. What's the topic that I'm going to talk today is... We were talking about company accounts. So today's session, it's going to be a blend of theory as well as practical. I'm going to talk about the area of oversubscription, undersubscription. Then we'll be talking about the area of the overall accounting system. Okay, we'll be talking about how they are exactly working. Now let's talk about the error. Which one of the following is not a feature of joint stock company now? Achha, now we are talking about present. It has an independent legal status, then common seal is mandatory to be affixed on all important documents. Members' liability is limited. And the last one is it is perpetual succession. When we talk about joint stock company, which feature is not anymore available? Oh. There's only one specific feature which is no more available. Now the common seal has been removed. There is no need to use common seal. Earlier it was there. There was a requirement to use common seal. Now it is not there anymore. Okay. So common seal is mandatory to be affixed on all important documents. Then, acha, Food Corporation of India is an example of. Okay. I think in May attempt only, I had seen one particular question coming up, and I think even in the November attempt as well, they had actually asked a question regarding these things. They had given the example of East India Company, the company which was working under Britishers, which had enslaved India for more than 200 years, right? So when we talk about Food Corporation of India, what is it? That was a particular question regarding that. East India Company was a chartered company, a company which was made under the Queen. And when when these companies are made under the name of the Queen, at that point of time, the Queen had a charter through which the companies would work. So that's why they are called chartered companies. Any company which is made at the time of Queen, they were called chartered companies. And yes, they are still legal because once the company is formed in any Companies Act, present 2013 or any previous act, which if the particular company was registered, it is a legal company. Statutory, chartered, private or holding company. FCI is basically an organization which is a statutory company. It is required by the statute. Statute means, statutory company means it is required by the law. Right? Next, when can a company issue equity shares at a discount? How can we issue the equity shares at a discount? If the company has not begun commercial production, if the company is in loss for the last 3 years, if the shares are issued to its own staff, or if the shares are issued as sweat equity. What can a company issue? When can a company issue equity shares at a discount, everyone? When we talk about a company issuing shares at a discount, वैसे तो in actual, the companies are not allowed to share any kind of, they are not allowed to issue any kind of shares at a discount, but only one kind of shares. That is if the shares are issued as sweat equity. Sweat equity, I've always thought of, there was a specific way of learning it now. This is the only a share which is allowed to be issued at a discount. If the value of the share is 100, since sweat equity is given to the directors of the company or the people who had given years of their service to the organization. So you can say this is khoon paseene ki kamai. Sweat is basically your paseena, or we can say if we talk about sweat is what you put hard work into it and then you perspire again, right? You are putting so much of hard work, or during the summers we have this. So sweat is what, because you are putting a lot of hard work, that's why you are getting it. That's why we define if the shares are issued as sweat equity. If the shares are issued as a sweat equity, they are covered in this region. Now, this is actually a question from the book itself, IIPF Macmillan book. Now look at the question. A company can forfeit the share already issued in which of the following situations? When a shareholder became insolvent, when the company is under liquidation, when a shareholder does not pay dues on the shares which he holds, or shares once issued cannot be forfeited. Why? Why won't they be forfeited? What do you mean by forfeiture? There, you were asking a particular person to pay you the amount. Basically, you issued shares and you ask the shareholders, ki, sir, ma'am, you are supposed to pay an amount of 100 rupees from your side, overall, total. Then maybe normally the share is of rupees 10, but I'm taking it as rupees 100 there. And out of this 100, The first people, the it was divided into different installments. Installment number 1, installment number 2, which was 30, installment number 3, which was 20, and installment number 4, which was say 30 again, you know. So technically, the person paid this one and this one, but he didn't pay the third one. We constantly called him ki you are supposed to pay, you are supposed to pay, why are you not paying? XYZ, we kept on saying so, but the person didn't pay. So the third one, the person didn't pay. So at this point of time, company has two options. Either the company keeps on asking him ki sir pay me, or the company says, this is it, we are forfeiting your share. I think you do not have any intention to keep this share, so we take the share away from him. So in this case, what will happen? When a shareholder does not pay the dues on the share which he holds, the company decides to remove or scrap off his name from the company's shareholders. Though this particular concept used to exist before the demat accounts, after the demat accounts have been introduced, if you are supposed to buy a share at rupees 100, then you are supposed to pay the entire amount together. So that means there is no trouble in terms of the payments there, right? So in this case, when a shareholder does not pay dues on the share which he holds. Anyhow, here comes the next question. Which one of the following statements is correct about minimum capital up to minimum paid up capital of a company? It is rupees 1 lakh for private, then 10 lakh for public, 5 lakh for private, or no minimum paid up capital. Earlier, this was there. Basically, in actual, it was stated that private are supposed to keep minimum 1 lakh and the public was supposed to keep 5 lakh. But when the 2013, the Companies Act 2013 came up, it seriously just came up and said there is no minimum paid up capital which is prescribed. That means if you want to start a private company, you can start it. You want to start a government company, that means you, sorry, not a government company. You want to make up a public company, a company in which public can invest, then that is something that is also allowed to you. ठीक है, so in this case, no minimum paid up capital is prescribed. That is also there. There is no minimum. Whatever you want to start with, you start with it. When forfeited shares are reissued, the amount of discount allowed on these shares cannot exceed 10% of the called up per share or 6% of the paid up capital per share. The amount received per share on forfeited shares or the unpaid amount per share on forfeited share. When forfeited shares are reissued. Achha, what happens is we ask a particular person, sir, your amount is due, your amount is due. So his calls were in arrear. He was supposed to pay, but he didn't pay the entire amount. He was constantly having a calls in arrears. Then we decided this is where we end our relationship and he is no more our shareholder. So now we scrap off his name and then we have forfeited shares. Enough. So if we have forfeited shares, what is the next thing that we'll do? If we have forfeited shares, 10% of the called up capital per share, 6% of the paid up capital per share, the amount received per share on forfeited share or unpaid amount. Basically, now if the shares are reissued, we'll be asking for the remaining amount. If the share was total of rupees 100 and the person had paid 20 and 30 and he didn't pay the next 20 and next 30, so technically when we issue the share, we'll issue for this remaining unpaid amount so that we get the amount, because already we have actually taken the we have confiscated half of the money of the share already. And for the new person, we can issue at a lower price and we can say ki from the previous owner I had already received 50, you pay me the remaining amount and the share would be yours. So they could get the share at a price which is a little lower. So in this case, that would be the amount received per share on the forfeited shares. चलिए, now talking about the next point, here comes a specific question, everyone. There was the following amounts were payable on issue of shares by a company. Application was 3, allotment was 3, first call 2, final call 2. X is someone who is holding 500 shares, paid only application and allotment. मतलब he has paid this and this, है ना? This is for X. While if I talk about why, he holds 400 shares and he did not pay the final call. He did not pay this call. So in this case, the answer would be the remaining 4 rupees here. And in this case, what will happen? That is 3, 3 and 2. 3, 3, 6, 6, 7, 8. Overall, 8. You know? So in this case, it's going to be 5, 4 or 20. 2000 rupees was left on the part of X, and overall 3200 rupees were left in the hands of B. Sorry, this is your X na, and this is your Y. So X and Y both are supposed to pay, so X has to give 2000 and the Y has to give the remaining. Aray, he was supposed to pay the arrears. This is a paid up that I'm talking about. I'm really sorry. The amount which is unpaid was 4 rupees for X. And for Y, it should be... He didn't pay the last call, na? So then, he's supposed to pay the last 2 rupees. So in this case, 2000 from this side and 800 from this side. So it's gonna be overall 2800 rupees that is in arrears. Arrears means the amount which is still pending. Rajan Limited issued 50,000 shares at a price lower than the nominal value of the share. The shares issued are called sweat equity, redeemable preference shares, equity shares or bonus shares. What's going to be the amount? Someone has issued 50,000 at lower than the nominal value. Normally, you're not allowed to issue lower than the nominal value amount. So, what if you're doing it? In this case, the right answer is going to be sweat equity. There is only one kind of equity shares which are allowed to be issued at a discount. And that is always and always sweat equity. And everyone... Shares can be forfeited for non-payment of the calls, for failure to attend the meetings, for failure to pay the loans, or for the failure for which shares are pledged as a security to bank. Shares can be forfeited for, they are basically forfeited for the non-repayment of call money. Okay? This is done when the person fails to pay the call money. Done. Next is the following statement apply to equity preference shareholders. Which one of the following applies only to preference shareholders? Shareholders risk the loss of investment. Shareholders bear the risk of no dividends in the event of the losses. Shareholders usually have the right to vote, or dividends are usually given at the set amount in every financial year. The amount statement apply to equity or preference shareholders. So when we talk about the preference shareholders, what's going to be the answer? The preference shareholders have a preference over equity over two things only. The things that they are working upon is that they are supposed to have in terms of the preference shareholders, I can say preference shareholders are given preference over equity at two points. First is when we have when we are paying dividend, and at the same time when we are at the time of liquidation. In both the timings, more value is given to that of preference shareholders. That is why they are called preference. They have more importance than that of equity. Okay? So in this case, shareholders bear the risk of number of dividends in the events of the losses. Matlab, shareholders have more, which of the following shareholders risk of loss of investments? Nahin. Then shareholders, they usually don't have the right to vote. Dividends are usually given at a set amount in the financial year. Yes, there is a set amount already. So in this case, I would go for this only. They have a certain amount. The point where these organizations really, matlab, the preference shareholders do not enjoy is they do not have the voting right as much as the equity, and at the same time, the dividend that they're going to receive is already predetermined. They won't receive anything extra if the company is making extra. You will get extra only if you are not an equity shareholder. Sorry, if you are an equity shareholder. My mistake. Equity shareholder will get anything that is left. So the leftover can be this much, and leftover can be just this much as well. So it will always vary if you are receiving too much amount of money or receiving almost no money. So preference shareholders are still at a better position than that of equity. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Officer 24/7. My name is Neharka Walia Bhatnagar, and I am with you with the area of AFM. I hope I am audible as well as visible. Apologies for the delay. Okay. But what is it that we are going to talk about today? Everybody, our sabse saste 5 din is here. That means at this point of time, if you are thinking to enroll into any of our courses, then you should enroll right away. Reason, sabse saste 5 din is here. From 29th to 2nd of January, you will get all our courses at the lowest prices. And that means you are not going to get it at 70% discount, 75%, or not even 81%. The discount now is of 85%, which is by far what you can say is one of the biggest ones that I have seen. So that means if I talk about the era of AFM, or if I talk about the entire preparation of JIB, everything is here. You just have to join in and become a part of the ADA team. That means you can join in for the entire studies, and then that too at a lower price through this particular time period. Then you will get it at the lowest price ever. Okay? Acha, chaliye, let's begin this. And at the same time, please go ahead and share this particular session, because it is very important. Your spirit of motivation towards me, this is something that makes my entire class more meaningful to me, definitely. Okay, now we were talking about module B. In this case, what are we talking about? Module B, company accounts 2. We were talking about company accounts 1 in the last class. So I'm continuing with the company accounts 2 today. And when we talk about this, this is the first question. The first question is, the following statements apply to the equity shareholders. Which one of them applies only to the preference shareholder? Okay, everybody, if you are looking over to the courses now, then use the code Y541. Just a moment. Use the code Y541 to get 85% discount. But this is only till 2nd of Jan. This offer will end soon. So if you are planning to buy our courses, then please go ahead and use the code Y541. Okay. Let's continue. The particular question says, when we talk about preference share, how is it different from that of equity? Preference shares have got a benefit there, that the preference shareholders can get the amount even when the company is having little amount. Equity shareholders will face problems because there is a rule. Equity shareholders cannot get the money in the way everybody else gets. They get a residual amount. If a good amount of money is left, they're good luck. If not a good amount of money is left, then again, it is their fate, I would say. Because they are the scavengers. Scavenger means whatever is left, that is what they are left with. Now comes the shareholders' risk at the loss of investment. When there is a loss, the loss is for everyone. Be it equity, be it for preference. So not the point. Shareholders bear the risk of no dividends in the event of losses. This is for both. There is no point where preference has got more importance than equity. Shareholders usually have the right to vote. No. Preference shareholders can never get the right to vote until or unless. There's a condition. The condition says they will get it only and only when the preference shareholders are having a situation where the preference shareholders are not paid the dividend for the next 2 years. That's included. Then the dividend are usually given at the set amount in every financial year. Yes, they are given the amount every financial year. So technically, dividends are usually given at a set amount in every financial year. Okay. Then comes the first question. Afterwards, this is Joy Limited issued 250,000 shares of rupees 10 each at a premium of rupees 1 as a application is 2.5 per application. In terms of shares, you will always find there have different installments. What are those installments, everyone? The installments are of application, which is of 2.5 rupees. Then is of rupees 4, which is allotment. Then is for the remaining in the first and final call, 6.5 is done. Then we are left with 3.5, that is first and final call. Now, applications were received for 5 lakh equity shares, but the company allotted them only 2 lakh 50 shares. Excess money was applied towards the area of allotment. People applied for shares which was more than the current values. So then last call of 500, there were people who didn't pay the money. So we asked them for money, they didn't pay, and ultimately their shares were forfeited after the due notice. The question says this is a case of what? Oversubscription. Oversubscription means we have 250,000 shares only. We have a limit, but the applications received are of 5 lakh. Then comes the specific area of prorata. Prorata means we are not giving complete subscription. We're going to give half. We cannot give. See, if I have 2 bottles, even if the person asks for 3 bottles of Coke, I can still give only the one which I have. So the limit is only what you have. If the company can issue only 2,50,000, they can issue only 2,50,000. Forfeiture is where you issue the shares, and then what happens is there is a forfeiture. What do you mean by forfeiture? You asked people, ki, sir, your amount is pending. Sir, your amount is pending. But they didn't pay the amount. So ultimately, you are scrapping off their name from the organization's list of shareholders. So technically, all these 3 points are covered in this long case study. Now, this case study can also be converted into a practical question. What is the amount total received in allotment? What is the total amount received in application? What is the total amount of money which was pro rata? What is the amount which was excess? All those things can be actually asked to be calculated, and this particular question can be converted into 3 to 4 different set of questions minimum. So that's the point regarding this. Okay, the correct answer is all of the above. So let me put it that way. Done. The answer is all of the above. Okay. Now, okay. I hope the questions are clearly visible. I just saw it just now that it wasn't visible properly. So, I hope it is visible now, right? Now moving on to the next set of questions. The next question says, which one of the following, this is for the area of company accounts 2, where you are going to study about the various classification of various areas in terms of the tangible and intangible assets. Is basically classification of all the assets and liabilities which are a part of the balance sheet. Which one of the following is not classified under intangible assets? Brands, trademarks, computer hardware, mining rights, goodwill. Intangible assets are those assets which cannot be touched. So if it cannot be touched, then what would be the answer? Brands, trademarks cannot be touched. So that is true. Which of the following is not classified under the intangible assets? Which one is not, everyone? What would be the answer in this case? Brand, trademarks is basically something which is an intangible asset. You cannot touch it. Mining rights, you cannot touch it. Goodwill, you cannot touch it. But computer hardware, I can touch my PC. That's why I'm teaching you. So technically, in this case, what I'm doing, computer hardware is a tangible asset. Tangible means something that can be touched. Taken? Done? Here comes the next question. Which one of the following is not the list of statements which form a set of financial statements as per Ind AS 1? statement of changes in equity for the period, statement of changes in assets for the period, statement of profit and loss for the period, and comparative information in respect of previous accounting period. What would be your answer? Among the following, which is not the list of statements which is formed in terms of AS1? Acha, AS1 includes your balance sheet, your profit and loss account, the schedule for the same. All these things are included in it. So P&L is a part of it. Equity is also part of it. Then comparative information of the previous, is this is also required. They, when they prepare the books of accounts, this is your current year and you also have your previous year as well. That's how you show your books of accounts. So this is also a part of it. This is also a part of it. This is also a part of it. So the answer is actually this is also shown. You do not prepare the statement of changes in assets of the period. Technically, this was given in the IIBF book, but the correct answer is comparative information in respect of a previous accounting period is already shown. Achha, but when we talk about, is not the complete list of statements which form complete set of... automatically this happens, but this is not outrightly said. So then we can say overall statement of changes in assets for the period is never shown. So I would still go with B. B is not the correct one. This is not shown. D is automatically taken into it. So basically the answer is B. Okay, here comes the next question. In the balance sheet of the company, the trade receivables are required to be sub-classified into three categories. Which one of the following is not among the among these? When we talk about the trade receivables are of three types. Secured and considered good. Then secured and considered good. And last one is dead loss. So that is, all of these are a part of it. So secured and unsecured are always a part of it, but there is nothing called there is nothing called doubtful. We have secured, unsecured. So I think there is some issue with the options that I've taken up. Let me just correct it for you. The correct answer is, we don't say the term. Because when we talk about trade receivables, we cover this particular category. Okay? Chaliye, let's continue further. The next question is this. Which one of the following entities is required to present consolidated financial statements? Okay, consolidated financial statements are those companies basically which have a share in some other company. And that is very significant. So technically, you are actually owning that specific organization. So all companies having more than one division, all government companies, entities that control one or more other entities, all the companies are required to present consolidated financial statements. What is it that we are going to do? Which one of the following entities is required to present consolidated statements? So when we talk about this area, all companies... all the companies are required. So technically this is wrong. D is definitely not the answer. And at the same time, all government companies are not required to do this. Now when we talk about entities that control more than one division, that answer is going to be C, everyone. If I talk about this question, the answer is going to be C. Entities that control one or more entities are to be covered in this area. Achha, next question. In the prescribed format of statement of profit and loss account, which one of the following items is not included? Which one of the following is not included, everyone? EPS or earning per equity share, then profit before tax, profit and loss for the period, or PE ratio. Which one of the following is not included? EPS is a part of it. PAT, PBT, all are a part of it. Profit or loss is also a part of it. The thing which is not a part of it is PE ratio. Profit, the profit calculation when we are preparing the P&L only, na, all these things are visible. EPS is automatically calculated, it's a part of the format itself. Profit before tax has to be calculated because we have to show the tax calculation as well. So profit for the period is automatically shown. So these three are not something where you have to put an extra effort to show, but you have to put an extra effort when we are talking about PE ratio. Right? Next point, which one of the following is classified as a current liability in the final books of accounts? Buildings, debentures, goodwill, machinery. Among the following, which one will include it? Building, debentures, goodwill, or machinery. Current liability is basically the liability which is basically something which we have only for less than 1 year. Okay. Now, which of the following items is classified as current liability? Technically, this is not a current liability. Actually, this is a non-current liability. In this case, debentures ideally are considered as a non-current liability. Now, this correct answer would be debentures. ठीक है? चलिए, now moving on to the next question. This is actually a non-current liability. So I think the question has to be rephrased. Which of the following is a non-current liability? A building, goodwill, machinery. They are all non-current assets. And under non-current assets, you can further classify these three as this is a fixed asset or a tangible asset. This is actually a tangible one. This is also a tangible one. This is intangible, something which we cannot touch at all, है ना? This is the answer. That is debentures. In the income statement of the company, where would you find the items dividend paid? Operating expense, other income, financing activities, investing activities. Dividend paid is basically the money which is paid to the shareholders as a reward because they have invested their money in the business. So when they have invested the money in the business, what will it be called? The dividend paid will be called the financing activity because to keep the finances running, you want finances for the business. You want the finances to be invested in your company. And for that, what will you do? To keep this particular finance in your business, you will always look forward to giving them rewards so that they stay in the organization. So dividend is basically a reward which is given to the equity shareholders to continue their investments in the organization. Then, what category would share capital fall under the balance sheet of a company? Current liability, fixed asset, equity and liabilities, and current assets. Equity share capital. Share capital is something which is the shareholders' funds. Basically, now in the top or in the balance sheet, they have equity and liabilities. They call it equity and liabilities, and then they write it as shareholder funds. So when we write in the shareholder funds, which is the equity itself, they have equity share capital, they have preference share capital, and they have reserves and surplus. These three things are a part of the portion that is equity and liabilities. ठीक है? Everything else is current and non-current. Non-current things are the things which are there in the business for a long term, right? And current are those which are for less than 1 year. That is equity and liabilities. Where would the sales revenue typically be reported in the company's income statement? Sales revenue typically be reported in a company's income statement, cost of goods sold, other income, operating expenses, or operating revenue. What is sales revenue, everyone? The income that you are earning because you are doing your business, isn't it? So in this case, what's going to be the answer? The answer is going to be operating revenue. ठीक है? The answer is actually operating income is operating revenue. The income that you earn because you are running your business. You are running your business. The answer is operating revenue. What is the classification of retained earnings in the equity section of the company's balance sheet. Current liabilities, non-current liabilities, shareholders' equity, or current assets. What is the classification of retained earnings? When we talk about retained earnings, this is that part of equity which we are keeping separately, which we are retaining. Retaining means we are saving. ठीक है, वी आर सेविंग. सो इन दिस केस अगेन आई टोल्ड यू इक्विटी शेयर कैपिटल प्रेफरेंस. फर्स्ट इज इक्विटी, सेकेंड इज प्रेफरेंस, एंड थर्ड इज द रिजर्व्स इन सरप्लस विच इंक्लूड्स और द अदर नेम ऑफ इट इज रिटेन्ड अर्निंग्स. सो ऑल दीज थिंग्स आर अ पार्ट ऑफ शेयर होल्डर्स. वी एक्चुअली कॉल इट शेयर होल्डर्स फंड्स. So in this case, the right answer is only one part matches, that is C. That is shareholders' equity is the answer. Done, everyone? Okay. Hello, everyone. Happy New Year. I hope this particular year brings all the happiness, joy, and health and wealth for all of us. This is the first session that we are having on in the year 2024. So one particular request, please keep on liking and sharing the sessions. Every single day we are working hard, we are coming up for you so that you are getting all the content which is required for the examination. And if you find these particular classes helpful, then what you can do is you can share it, you can like it, because that's the source of motivation for all of us. So please go ahead and like this particular session and share it among your peers. Okay, everybody, since now we have entered the new year, but have we entered with the new module yet? No, we are still left with a little part of module B. So let's finish up the module B first, and then that would be followed by C and D later as well. So let's go on and talk about module B further. Today I'm starting with another chapter, you can say another unit, that is cash flow and fund flow. What do you mean by cash flow, and how is it different from fund flow? Because funds and cash, it's all about money, no? The money movement. So what's the difference between the two? The difference is cash flow talks only and strictly about movement of money. It doesn't talk about anything else. While fund flow talks about in a broader concept, fund flow is basically something which talks about the movement of funds overall. Okay? So movement of funds means if you are supposed to receive money in future from someone, if you're going to pay money to someone in future, that is also covered in this area. So it considers a lot of things which cash flow doesn't take up, right? So technically this particular unit is unit number 16. Out of 35 units, we are almost at 50% of the syllabus right now. Okay, so let's continue further. Now we were talking about cash flow and fund flow now. Let me give you a little brief information about cash flow first. Then we'll move on to fund flow as well. This is cash flow and this is fund flow. Cash flow says there are three kind of activities in cash. First is operating. Second is investing. Third is financing. Operating is when we talk about money. Investing is about when we talk about investing is about operating is about your business actually. Business means if funds are coming in your business, funds are going out of your business, that is operating. Investing is something where we are purchasing or selling any long term asset, because you're investing money in something, investing money in shares, you're putting money in some machinery, that's investment, right? And then from where are you getting the money? You're getting the money from shareholders, you're getting the money from borrowing, all those things are there. So that is a part of financing. So the loans, the borrowings, they're all a part of it. Okay, that's a part of financing. So cash flow can be divided into three parts: operating, investing, and financing activities. Now, this is cash flow. This is divided as per AS3 and IND AS7. As per SEBI, that is Securities and Exchange Board of India, there are two methods of cash flow. One is indirect, the second is direct. The difference is in the format. As per SEBI, they say that you should use indirect method only as per Securities and Exchange Board of India. That is why in the examination, the indirect method is more important, though they can also ask you the questions on the basis of identification of activities. If they'll give you a transaction, is it talking about operating, is it talking about investing, or is it talking about financing? That's a part that we'll be doing. Then the part is of fund flow. What do you mean by fund flow? Movement of funds. Okay, this is called movement of funds. What happens in a fund flow then? In terms of fund flow, first and foremost thing is movement of funds. Now we have current asset and non-current asset. We have current liability and non-current liability. Whenever the movement is between two currents or two non-currents, it is not fund flow. When one is a current one, the other one is a non-current one. If you pay any loan with cash or bank balance, this is basically fund flow. If you are using an asset to pay off your current liability, matlab you used sold something, some asset, and then you paid your creditor because they were asking for too much money and you didn't have that point of time, and then you were like jaldi se de do, that means just get an asset, rid of asset, and we'll be again getting the project and then we'll get it done. So organization does this when they're in a crunch or something, na? So that's why they might use this. Then current asset and non-current asset. Now this is vice versa, that can also be done, and current liability and non-current. This means you cannot have both currents or both non-currents. If it is both current, then it is called working capital, which is current asset minus current liability. Okay, so that is what we call in this era. We have cash flow and we have fund flow. These are two. Okay, I hope now the entire part is visible. So we have two of these things, and the difference between the two lies here. You can see the topics are totally different. Their way of presentation, their way of telling the answer is totally different from the other one, right? So that's the entire concept of cash flow and the concept of fund flow. What next do we have? Let's begin with some reclassification based questions, and then we'll move on to that. In the balance sheet, where is inventory typically classified, everyone? In the balance sheet, where do you put the term inventory? Current liabilities, fixed assets, current assets, or shareholders equity? When we talk about balance sheet, inventory means the goods that we are keeping for sale. So when we are keeping something for sale, that is something that we don't want to keep for more than a year, not even 3 months. People just want to sell their goods off as early. They're just entering the warehouse, they're like, just sell it off. They don't want to keep it in the business there. So in this case, what would be the correct answer? The correct answer is going to be current assets. The answer is C. Now, the next point, where would amortization of patents be reported in the financial statements? Just like depreciation is there, depreciation is in case of tangibles. Amortization is in case of intangibles. Okay. So that includes operating expense, non-operating expense, income, financing activities, or the other comprehensive income. Amortization, that means I'm writing off my goodwill, maybe a patent, copyright, whatever that case might be. Now in this case, patent is amortized. That means an intangible asset is getting lesser. So if its value is declining, it's an expense, right? And that is because we are using the particular patent in business, because we buy the patents or we create the patents because we are doing the business. So in this case, the correct answer is going to be operating expenses. the expenses that we incur because we are running the business. Where would the preliminary expenses be recorded in the company's financial statements? Operating expense, intangible asset, other comprehensive income, or current liabilities? Preliminary expenses are those expenses which are related to the area of before the organization was ready as a company. The expenses that we incur are called preliminary. Preliminary expenses can be specified as the earlier they used to, this is a fictitious asset. Why? Because we have already created the company. Why are we writing those expenses? They say we are just capitalizing it over the period of time. We will use it as an expense. For example, the total preliminary expenses. The expenses to build up the company was total 1 lakh. They said divide it by 5 and give 20,000 per annum. Right? This is the amount that you have to give per annum. So overall, 5 years, entire preliminary expenses gone. This is again an expense which we can treat as an intangible asset. Writing off is covered in profit and loss account, and noting of it is done in the balance sheet. Then, what is the main purpose of the cash flow statement? To determine the profit, or to assess the liquidity and the cash position of the enterprise, to calculate return on investment, or evaluate market trends. Cash flow is something which strictly talks about two things, inflow and outflow of cash. It doesn't talk about anything else. So this is to assess the liquidity and the cash position. So it talks about cash inflow or cash outflow, because it is obsessed with cash and cash equivalents. What are those? That means cash, bank balance, that is also equal to cash, and then is marketable securities. The securities which we are holding so that we can sell them off. And everyone, the answer is to assess the liquidity and cash position of the enterprise. In the cash flow statement, where do operating activities typically include cash transactions? Purchase of long-term investments, issuance of common stock, day-to-day business operations, payment of long-term debt. Now, in cash flow statement, in terms of operating activities means the activities which you are doing to get money through your business operations. You're trying to get money from your business, so purchase of long-term investments. You don't do it for your business. This is to expand your business. This is not our day-to-day business. So, another point is, I just said the word day-to-day. Issue of common stock, that means issue of shares. So again, this is not something that I can call here. Payment of long-term debt, something again, it is a finance-based thing. So in this case, only C point, that is day-to-day business operations, is the answer. What does a negative cash flow from operating activities indicate? The company is generating sufficient cash to cover its operating expenses. The company is experiencing a cash deficit from its core business operations. The company is highly profitable. The company has high liquidity. When we talk about the negative cash flow from operating activities, negative cash flow means probably this year we have earned less and then we have paid more. So how are we managing that? Because I cannot have minus 20 in my pocket. It can be based upon, in the beginning of the year I had 10 rupees, and during the year maybe I had an income of 20 rupees but I saw an expense of 22. So technically I faced a deficit of 2 rupees. For that, how did I cover it up? I used my previous cash. That means by the end of the year I was left with rupees 8 only. Okay? So in this case we are having a deficit, a negative income. That is what they are saying. Negative cash flow can be there, But negative cash balance is never there. You can never have minus 20 rupees in your pocket, minus 40. This doesn't happen. The company in this case is experiencing a cash deficit from its core business operations. This is from your business operations only, right? That is what we determined in this area. What is the primary objective of cash flow statement? The primary objective of cash flow is to find out the movement of cash. There can be nothing else. Determining profit, P&L is made for that. Evaluating market trends, again, this is not our problem. Analyzing balance sheet changes, we have comparative balance sheet statements for that. The comparative analysis is done through tools which have been defined for financial analysis. So in this case, the correct answer is going to be assessing liquidity and cash position. So in this case, you are doing it to see the movement of then which category of activities includes the acquisition and disposal of long-term assets in cash flow statements, operating, investing, financing, non-cash. Which category of activities include acquisition? You are purchasing and selling a long-term asset. Operating says, no, I don't deal with it. This is not a non-cash as well, because you are selling and getting the payment for that now. Financing is to get loans or managing the loans. So in this case, the answer is investing activities. How are cash equivalents defined in the context of cash flow statement? Long-term investment. Then we have highly liquid investment with insignificant risk of value changes, marketable securities or fixed assets. Cash equivalent is basically something which is just like cash, as liquid as it, and more stability is there. Matlab, for example, marketable securities are those securities where the price of that particular security doesn't change that doesn't change frequently. That's what they call it. So in this case, the securities are basically highly liquid investments with insignificant risk of value changes. There won't be major value changes in the short term. Long term, though, we don't know, but in the short term, yeah, there won't be much. Then, what activities fall under the category of financing activities in the cash flow statement? Revenue producing activities, changes in the size and composition of contributed equity and borrowings, acquisition of long-term assets, or day-to-day business operations. What activities fall under the category of financing activities? Financing means through which you are arranging the funds for the company. Because that's what we talk about, be it equity, be it debt, be it the owners of the organization or the lenders which have given the money. So answer is B. The changes in the size and the composition contributed by equity and borrowings. Acha everyone, I hope you have already reviewed one particular thing. At this point of time, the biggest sale for the season is here, and today is the last day for it, right? So this means if you are preparing for this examination, then hurry up, enroll right away, because 85% discount is available only till today. It is ending today. Last day of sale is here, so please go ahead and enroll yourself. Get 85% discount and double validity on our Mahapacks as well. On the normal courses, you will find 85% discount, and on our Mahapacks, you will find 85% discount plus double validity. So please enroll yourself. Use the code Y541. You can see it at the top. You can use the specific code and you can get yourself enrolled in our courses as early as possible. Right? Okay. Why do cash flows exclude movements between items that constitute cash or cash equivalents? To simplify financial statements, to focus on cash management, to enhance investing activities, or to reduce operating activities. Why do cash flows exclude movements? The cash flows really leaves a few things which between the constitutes everyone. It's about the form. If I had water in one bottle and I move it to another, that's not the water is increasing or decreasing, it's just a movement. So when you are moving the money from bank to cash to bank, you have the same amount in your pocket. The variation will come when you will get bank interest. Till then, if you're moving the money here and there, that just doesn't make a difference, doesn't it? So in this case, the answer is to focus on cash management. Their focus is just to find out what is the amount of cash that we are carrying right now and if we can reconcile it easily or not. right? Because they had to give hard proofs to the government. In a single transaction involving repayment, how might the interest and loan element be classified? Interest and loan element means if we have taken the loan, then we are supposed to return it. Hena? That is, it is both operating activities, interest as investing, loan as financing, then interest as financing, loan as investing, and both are financing activities. When we take a loan or we repay a loan, technically in this case interest as financing. If you have taken a particular loan for the business growth, in this case you are making the payment, and if it is related to the area of financing, then whatever interest you are also paying, that is also the portion of the business there. So in this case, interest the interest that you are paying to acquire a specific area specifically for your business, then the loan that you would have paid, that is something which is a part of this. For example, we are making the payment now. We have taken a loan, that is also financing. The loan has also has to be financing. And interest is something that we'll be taking up and cancelling it up with the area of operating. In this case, the loan repayment is financing activity, and the interest is also a part of the financing activity. And in the operating expenses area, na, you will include this as a finance expense. Okay? That is what we'll be talking about. So technically, this answer that interest is financing, it is as financing, and there is nothing else in it. Hello everyone, happy new year. I hope this particular year brings all the happiness, joy, and health and wealth for all of us. This is the first session that we are having on in the year 2024. So one particular request, please keep on liking and sharing the sessions. Every single day we are working hard, we are coming up for you, so that you are getting all the content which is required for the examination. And if you find these particular classes helpful, then what you can do is you can share it, you can like it, because that's the source of motivation for all of us. So please go ahead and like this particular session and share it among your peers. Okay, everybody, since now we have entered the new year, but have we entered with the new module yet? No, we are still left with a little part of module B. So let's finish up the module B first, and then that would be followed by C and D later as well. So let's go on and talk about module B further. Today I'm starting with another chapter, or you can say another unit, that is cash flow and fund flow. What do you mean by cash flow, and how is it different from fund flow? Because funds and cash, it's all about money, no? The money movement. So what's the difference between the two? The difference is cash flow talks only and strictly about movement of money. It doesn't talk about anything else. While fund flow talks about in a broader concept, fund flow is basically something which talks about the movement of funds overall. Okay, so movement of funds means if you are supposed to receive money in future from someone, if you're going to pay money to someone in future, that is also covered in this area. So it considers a lot of things which cash flow doesn't take up, right? So technically this particular unit is unit number 16. Out of 35 units, we are almost at 50% of the syllabus right now. Okay, so let's continue further. Now, we were talking about cash flow and fund flow now. Let me give you a little brief information about cash flow first. Then we'll move on to fund flow as well. This is cash flow and this is fund flow. Cash flow says there are three kind of activities in cash. First is operating. Second is investing. Third is financing. Operating is when we talk about money. Investing is about when we talk about investing is about Operating is about your business actually. Business means if funds are coming in your business, funds are going out of your business, that is operating. Investing is something where we are purchasing or selling any long term asset because you're investing money in something. Investing money in shares, you're putting money in some machinery. That's investment, right? And then from where are you getting the money? You're getting the money from shareholders, you're getting the money from borrowing. All those things are there. So that is a part of financing. So the loans, borrowings, they're all a part of it. Okay, that's a part of financing. So cash flow can be divided into three parts: operating, investing, and financing activities. Now, this is cash flow. This is divided as per AS3 and IND AS7. As per SEBI, that is Securities and Exchange Board of India, there are two methods of cash flow. One is indirect, the second is direct. The difference is in the format. As per SEBI, they say that you should use indirect method only as per Securities and Exchange Board of India. That is why in the examination, the indirect method is more important, though they can also ask you the questions on the basis of identification of activities. If they'll give you a transaction, is it talking about operating, is it talking about investing, or is it talking about financing? That's a part that we'll be doing. Then the part is of fund flow. What do you mean by fund flow? Movement of funds. Okay, this is called movement of funds. What happens in a fund flow then? In terms of fund flow, first and foremost thing is movement of funds. Now, we have current asset and non-current asset. We have current liability and non-current liability. Whenever the movement is between two currents or two non-currents, it is not fund flow. When one is a current one, the other one is a non-current one. If you pay any loan with cash or bank balance, this is basically fund flow. If you are using an asset to pay off your current liability, matlab you sold something, some asset, and then you paid your creditor because they were asking for too much money and you didn't have that point of time, and then you were like jaldi se de do, that means just get an asset, rid of asset, and we'll be again getting the project and then we'll get it done. So organization does this when they're in a crunch or something, na? So that's why they might use this. Then current asset and non-current asset. Now this is vice versa, that can also be done, and current liability and non-current. This means you cannot have both currents or both non-currents. If it is both current, then it is called working capital, which is current asset minus current liability. Okay, so that is what we call in this era. We have cash flow and we have fund flow. These are two. Okay, I hope now the entire part is visible. So we have two of these things, and the difference between the two lies here. You can see the topics are totally different. Their way of presentation, their way of telling the answer is totally different from the other one, right? So that's the entire concept of cash flow and the concept of fund flow. What next do we have? Let's begin with some reclassification based questions, and then we'll move on to that. In the balance sheet, where is inventory typically classified, everyone? In the balance sheet, where do you put the term inventory? Current liabilities, fixed assets, current assets, or shareholders equity? When we talk about balance sheet, inventory means the goods that we are keeping for sale. So when we are keeping something for sale, that is something that we don't want to keep for more than a year, not even 3 months. People just want to sell their goods off as early. They're just entering the warehouse, they're like, just sell it off. They don't want to keep it in the business there. So in this case, what would be the correct answer? The correct answer is going to be current assets. The answer is C. Now, The next point, where would amortization of patents be reported in the financial statements? Just like depreciation is there, depreciation is in case of tangibles. Amortization is in case of intangibles. Okay, so that includes operating expense, non-operating expense, income, in financing activities, or the other comprehensive income. Amortization, that means I'm writing off my goodwill, maybe a patent, copyright, whatever that case might be. Now in this case, patent is amortized. That means an intangible asset is getting lesser. So if its value is declining, it's an expense, right? And that is because we are using the particular patent in business, because we buy the patents or we create the patents because we are doing the business. So in this case, the right answer is going to be operating expenses, the expenses that we incur because we are running the business. Where would the preliminary expenses be recorded in the company's financial statements? Operating expense, intangible asset, other comprehensive income, or current liabilities. Preliminary expenses are those expenses which are related to the area of before the organization was ready as a company. The expenses that we incur are called preliminary. Preliminary expenses can be specified as the earlier they used to, this is a fictitious asset. Why? Because we have already created the company. Why are we writing those expenses? They say we are just capitalizing it over the period of time. We will use it as an expense. For example, the total preliminary expenses. The expenses to build up the company was total 1 lakh. They said divide it by 5 and give 20,000 per annum. Right? This is the amount that you have to give per annum. So overall, 5 years, entire preliminary expenses gone. This is again an expense which we can treat as an intangible asset. Writing off is covered in profit and loss account, and noting of it is done in the balance sheet. Then, what is the main purpose of the cash flow statement? To determine the profit, or to assess the liquidity and the cash position of the enterprise, to calculate return on investment, or evaluate market trends. Cash flow is something which strictly talks about two things, inflow and outflow of cash. It doesn't talk about anything else. So this is to assess the liquidity and the cash position. So it talks about cash inflow or cash outflow, because it is obsessed with cash and cash equivalents. What are those? That means cash, bank balance, that is also equal to cash, and then is marketable securities, the securities which we are holding so that we can sell them off. Done, everyone? The answer is to assess the liquidity and cash position of the enterprise. In the cash flow statement, where do operating activities typically include cash transactions? Purchase of long-term investments, issuance of common stock, day-to-day business operations, payment of long-term debt. Now, in cash flow statement, in terms of operating activities means the activities which you are doing to get money through your business operations. You're trying to get money from your business, so purchase of long-term investments. You don't do it for your business. This is to expand your business. This is not our day-to-day business. So, another point is, I just said the word day-to-day. Issue of common stock, that means issue of shares. So again, this is not something that I can call here. Payment of long-term debt, something again, it is a finance-based thing. So in this case, only C point, that is day-to-day business operations, is the answer. What does a negative cash flow from operating activities indicate? The company is generating sufficient cash to cover its operating expenses. The company is experiencing a cash deficit from its core business operations. The company is highly profitable. The company has high liquidity. When we talk about the negative cash flow from operating activities, negative cash flow means probably this year we have earned less and then we have paid more. So how are we managing that? Because I cannot have minus 20 in my pocket. It can be based upon, in the beginning of the year I had 10 rupees, and during the year maybe I had an income of 20 rupees but I saw an expense of 22. So technically I faced a deficit of 2 rupees. For that, how did I cover it up? I used my previous cash. That means by the end of the year I was left with rupees 8 only. Okay? So in this case we are having a deficit, a negative income. That is what they are saying. Negative cash flow can be there, but negative cash balance is never there. You can never have minus 20 rupees in your pocket, minus 40. This doesn't happen. The company in this case is experiencing a cash deficit from its core business operations. This is from your business operations only, right? That is what we determined in this area. What is the primary objective of cash flow statement? The primary objective of cash flow is to find out the movement of cash. There can be nothing else. Determining profit, P&L is made for that. Evaluating market trends, again, this is not our problem. Analyzing balance sheet changes, we have comparative balance sheet statements for that. The comparative analysis is done through tools which have been defined for financial analysis. So in this case, the correct answer is going to be assessing liquidity and cash position. So in this case, you are doing it to see the movement of Then which category of activities includes the acquisition and disposal of long-term assets in cash flow statements? Operating, investing, financing, non-cash. Which activities of which category of activities include acquisition? You are purchasing and selling a long-term asset. Operating says, no, I don't deal with it. This is not a non-cash as well, because you are selling and getting the payment for that. Now, financing is to get loans or managing the loans. So in this case, the answer is investing activities. How are cash equivalents defined in the context of cash flow statement? Long-term investment, then we have highly liquid investment with insignificant risk of value changes, marketable securities or fixed assets. Cash equivalent is basically something which is just like cash, as liquid as it, and more stability is there. For example, marketable securities are those securities where the price of that particular security doesn't change that doesn't change frequently. That's what they call it. So in this case, the securities are basically highly liquid investments with insignificant risk of value changes. There won't be major value changes in the short term. Long term, though, we don't know. But in the short term, yeah, there won't be much. Then what activities fall under the category of financing activities in the cash flow statement? Revenue producing activities, changes in the size and composition of contributed equity and borrowings, acquisition of long-term assets, or day-to-day business operations. What activities fall under the category of financing activities? Financing means through which you are arranging the funds for the company. Because that's what we talk about, be it equity, be it debt, be it the owners of the organization or the lenders which have given the money. So answer is B. The changes in the size and the composition contributed by equity and borrowings. Acha, everyone, I hope you have already reviewed one particular thing. At this point of time, the biggest sale for the season is here, and today is the last day for it. Right, so this means if you are preparing for this examination, then hurry up, enroll right away, because 85% discount is available only till today. It is ending today. Last day of sale is here, so please go ahead and enroll yourself. Get 85% discount and double validity on our Mahapacks as well. On the normal courses, you will find 85% discount, and in on our Mahapacks, you will find 85% discount plus double validity. So please enroll yourself. Use the code Y541. You can see it at the top. You can use the specific code and you can get yourself enrolled in our courses as early as possible. Right? Okay. Why do cash flows exclude movements between items that constitute cash or cash equivalents? To simplify financial statements, to focus on cash management, to enhance investing activities, or to reduce operating activities. Why do cash flows exclude movements? The cash flows really leaves a few things which between the constitutes everyone. It's about the form. If I had water in one bottle and I move it to another, that's not the water is increasing or decreasing. It's just a movement. So when you are moving the money from bank to cash, cash to bank, you have the same amount in your pocket. The variation will come when you will get bank interest. Till then, if you're moving the money here and there, that just doesn't make a difference, doesn't it? So in this case, the answer is to focus on cash management. Their focus is just to find out what is the amount of cash that we are carrying right now and if we can reconcile it easily or not, right? Because they had to give hard proofs to the government. In a single transaction involving repayment, how might the interest and loan element be classified? Interest and loan element means if we have taken the loan, then we are supposed to return it. That is, it is both operating activities, interest as investing, loan as financing, then interest as financing, loan as investing, and both are financing activities. When we take a loan or we repay a loan, technically in this case interest as financing. If you have taken a particular loan for the business growth, in this case you are making the payment, and if it is related to the area of financing, then whatever interest you are also paying, that is also the portion of the business there. So in this case, interest the interest that you are paying to acquire a specific area specifically for your business, then the loan that you would have paid, that is something which is a part of this. For example, we are making the payment now. We have taken a loan, that is also financing. The loan has also has to be financing. And interest is something that we'll be taking up and cancelling it up with the area of operating. In this case, the loan repayment is financing activity and the interest is also a part of the financing activity. And in the operating expenses area, you will include this as a finance expense. Okay? That is what we'll be talking about. So technically, this answer that interest is financing, it is as financing and there is nothing else in it. We are talking about CBS. CBS is a system which is responsible for all the accounting which is done in a computerized form, and this has revolutionized the entire working which is done in the banks, because the entire softwares and everything that they have developed has helped a lot in the development of these areas altogether. Right? So when we talk about the CBS, there are different areas where it is used, and I believe most of the working is now totally computerized. Hardly a few things which are left. They are just the vouchers which are in the physical form right now. That too is required, because if we are dealing with the other way around, then we need to know what is happening with our normal books and all. What is happening? Where's the documentation for? Where's the authorization of person? If it's all computerized, how can we recheck it? Another important point. Then what is a computerized accounting? Here comes the first question. It's a manual recording for business transactions. It is basically a system that captures and processes business transactions using a computer. An accounting method without the use of financial statements or financial reporting without adherence to accounting standards. Okay, when we talk about this area, computerized accounting is basically the accounting which is totally working using a computer, where we are talking about using it for the business. And it is required. Even not every business can remain in that. Okay, the business cannot remain in that way na. That is what we can do is that we just follow the manual systems, because manual systems at one point of time might look cool, and but they're time consuming. Once the particular working becomes very exhaustive, when the working becomes very large scale based, so that's a problem which people face, isn't it? Then what are the physical components of a computer known as software, hardware, peripherals or instructions? When we talk about the area of physical components of computer, physical components is software, hardware, peripherals or instructions. When we talk about the physical components, it's the hardware, the ones which can be touched is hardware. Then, okay, how is computer defined in context of electronic information processing? A device for generating inputs, an information storage device, an electronic information processing device with inputs, software and high speed outputs, a general purpose machine for financial reporting. When we talk about electronic information, for electronic information processing, it is very, very important. I think the answer would be C only. An electronic information processing device with inputs, outputs, software. It's basically a system is what? If we define the computer, we are doing things by, it's a device base. It is based upon inputs. It is based upon the softwares as well as the high speed outputs. Now, if we talk about in computerized accounting, which of the following is a computer language that accounting software may be written in? English, COBOL, or then is accounting script or MATLAB? Among the following, which is a computer language? But I have basically in terms of accounting, not only accounting there are many different types of computer languages through which the computers understand our commands. Once they understand our commands, they work in a better way. Of course, their working definitely becomes way better because whatever we are telling them, they can run through the instructions, they can process the data, they can work upon the things in a proper manner, isn't it? So that's what we define under it. So then is it is not in English. It is not even accounting script or MATLAB. It is actually COBOL. That is COBOL. Okay. Then comes the next one, which is what is the primary advantage of using digital computers? Okay. Now when we talk about primary advantage of using digital computers in computerized accounting, continuous data processing, yeah, it can be done. Currently, I think if we talk about it, the banks are now working kind of around the clock. I can make an RD even in the night. I can transfer my money at 3 a.m. in the morning. I can open an account at any point of time, at any place. There is no problem in doing that. You know, that is, you don't have a problem in doing any of these things. So we have a continuous data processing. It's a high speed arithmetic operations. Use of COBOL language, of course it is used, but that's not an advantage, right? This is where the questions gets a little troublesome, because if you have not gone through the particular topics properly, you will feel you don't have to do it. But in this case, you will have to understand, you have to find the question, what exactly the question is looking forward to. Then is scientific and mechanical processing. When we talk about the primary advantage of using digital computers, it is we are having high speed arithmetic operations. Okay. So in this case, the correct answer is going to be high speed arithmetic operations. Then what is the key advantage of computerized accounting in terms of generating reports? Limit report options, time consuming report generation, inability to prepare informative reports or various informative reports can be generated quickly. Again, it is easier. The question could have been made a little more difficult. When we talk about the key advantage of computerized accounting, one of the strongest points is we don't have to prepare all the things manually. We put up all the information in the banks, right? We put up all the vital information and whatever we are dealing with. Ultimately, you get the particular point of the working in a simpler manner. So this is possible only because we are following this specific method, that is we are using computers. When we are using computers, it becomes super easy that the organization can work upon their data, they can work upon their overall, not only the data, but systematic way of working. Everything is possible by following this. So there's very informative information can reports can be generated, and those reports are as per the required formats only. That's because they are following it. You know, they just put all the data inside it, and when it has the data, there is no problem in working, isn't it? Okay. Then comes the next question. What do you mean? How does a data file? The question says, how does a data file define, how is a data file defined in computerized accounting? How do we define it? How is a data file defined, everyone? Compilation of unrelated data records, then collection of hardware components, then related data records maintained in a pre-arranged order, or group of data items related to an object. What would be the answer according to you? When we talk about data file is everything which is in a tabular form and it is connected. So can I say the answer is going to be group of data items which are related? Data file is basically, if I have noted down the name of all the bankers who have enrolled in JIIB and who is going to appear in 2024 may attempt. So in this case, what's going to be the answer? Technically, the related data records. Achha, in this case, the answer would be C, which is nearer to the point. Related data records maintained in some pre-arranged order. It is maintained in a pre-arranged order. And the answer is C. Then comes the next point. What does the term WAN stand for in context of the computerized system? This is again when we're talking about the era of the technical terms of computers, right? This is actually a very simple term though, but go ahead and try it out. It says local and wide area networks, then is linear and wide array network, and logical and wired access network, or limited and widespread access networks. What's the answer according to you? Basically, LAN and WAN is linked with the internet connections overall, na? So that is, LAN is basically linked with the wiring and all. So basically, it is helping us, the organizations, to connect us, to stay connected with the main servers, to do everything in terms of, in the form of the cables and all. So in this case, the correct answer is going to be local and wide area networks. Now comes, what is the real concern regarding the integrity of accounting data within a computerized database? Physical damage, spectacular computer frauds, lack of computer peripherals, or complexity of computer language? Real concern of integrity of accounting. Basically, one of the basic problems that I think everybody is correctly facing is frauds happening. What is happening? You get a random OTP, you get a random call, you pick it up, all the information that is there on your phone is transferred to the other person and they take out the money. I think there are so many frauds that have happened with people who didn't even know. And specifically, they had been targeting old people because they don't have any idea about technologies. And then those who do not have the technology-based idea, they will be asking for OTPs and everything. And then, boom, they are just taking the entire money out of their pockets. And that too, hard-earned money. And tracing these people down is very difficult at times because their IP addresses and everything is just not traceable. So these are spectacular computer frauds. Matlab, these are not small frauds. What they do is a higher level fraud. And when they do all those higher level frauds, they get a lot of money. And they are just vanishing in thin air. Nobody knows where they go. But the people who face it, they face it very badly because the banks do not take the responsibility of that particular task because they are maintaining their security while the person has no clue what has happened with to his account. So in this case, nobody can be held responsible, neither the person nor the bank. But the person who would have done it to recover the money, to find them up, is another level of challenge. That's why it is said that people need to take care of their belongings. Then they need to be more vigilant who are they talking about in terms of their banking information. Right? Because if I talk about giving my Aadhaar card number to anybody randomly, what will happen? The person will have the details of so many things altogether, no? The person will have the details of the class, of the particular vehicles that we own. The PAN number can be found out. The total overall money can be found out. The property that the person owns or is in her or his name. All those things can be done. So basically, this is so dangerous. If you do not use these information properly, then it can be a troublesome situation for both the persons. That means if there's a spouse and the spouse, then if it's related to your parents, then it will be the same manner as well. So technically, the very first problem is the spectacular computer frauds, which has made the particular fear coming up that what is exactly happening in this case. That is, it's a spectacular computer fraud. What is the primary requirement of computerized accounting system to carry out accounting operations? Special stationery, qualified staff, traditional books of accounts, or special programs written in by programmers? What is the primary requirement for computerized accounting system? Special stationery, qualified staff, then when we talk about this area, we need to carry out all these things by what? What is the primary requirement? You need special programs which are written by programmers, but they have to be prepared as per what? These have to be prepared as per actual accounting standards which are being followed. Whatever is in practice now, we have to follow all those things all together. Otherwise, there would be a major problem, right? Then comes the next point. Apart from the traditional books of accounts, what other costly items may a computer require in a computerized accounting system? Expensive furniture, then advanced computer language, costly computer peripherals and stationery, or specialized staff training. What would be the what would be the answer according to you, everyone? When we talk about this era, other than the traditional books, when you require all these costly things, the problem is that we need a lot of computer peripherals. For example, if I'm taking your classes, what is it that I need? I need a WAN connection. If that is not working, then I need LAN connection, right? Normally in houses, we have a LAN connection or we have Wi-Fi, right? And then we have if it's a small organization, maybe even 10 to 20 people are involved in it, then even you need the computerized system of accounting, because it is not possible for one particular person to write down the journal, then write down the ledger, and then the trial balance and the further financial statements. It takes a lot of effort to do all that, right? So that is what they had been talking about in India. You know, in terms of the accounting and everything else, this is what we have talked about in the CBS itself. That is costly computer peripherals and stationery. Since we have talked about all these things, this is not true that these organizations where the entire strict computer systems are working, the things are very bad. The things might been exposed to frauds and might have been seen a little out of threats and all, but still the computerized system is better, safer, and has more speed than anything else, right? Here comes the next question, everyone. Visible now? Okay, now what is the next point that we're talking about? We have talked about what does the software do in case of an entity with operations in the foreign countries regarding currency conversion? What would be the answer according to everyone? manually calculates currency rates or ignores currency foreign currency transactions. It cannot do that. Converts foreign currency to Indian rupee based upon the specified rate of exchange or skips currency conversion. It cannot. The manual calculation is also not required. It is based upon whatever the current price would be. We are going to consider that current price and we are going to gather all the information accordingly. That is what that is the current price going on. What should be the spot rate in this case? So the answer is actually C. Converts the foreign currency transaction into Indian rupee. Then in the case of an entity with branches all over India and abroad, what tasks does the software perform? The only maintains accounts of the heads, ignores branch accounts, maintains accounts of all branches and head office, prepares the consolidated trial balance and the financial statements. It excludes the preparation of financial trial balance, consolidated trial balance. What is going to be the answer according to everyone? Just a moment, I think now it would be visible in a better way. What's the answer in this case when we are basically talking about an entity which has branches outside India as well as abroad, and what tasks does the software perform? In this case, what's going to happen is if you put money into the any branch, the entire account, wherever you have it, your head office and everything else, it is updated altogether, you know. It technically maintains the accounts of all the branches and head office. It prepares a consolidated trial balance as well as a financial statement. It prepares all these things. So in this case, the answer is going to be it maintains accounts of all branches and the head office. It prepares a consolidated trial balance and financial statements. Overall, it is preparing all the books of accounts. Isn't it? Then which one, what is the one advantage of computerization of bank regarding deposit operations? Increased complexity, time consuming operations, ease and convenience and dependence on physical records. Which is the advantage of computerization? Computerization has major advantages because of that there is no complexity which has increased. Though it is complex on the part of software, but not in the working. Time consuming operations, they were earlier. Now the one thing, one particular place is updated, the entire books of accounts are done within no time. Then easy and convenience of in operations and accounting for deposit accounts and dependence on physical records. There is no dependence on physical records. So technically, due to these accounts, the organizations can gather a lot of information and they can work in a better way. That is ease and convenience in operations. Next is, how does computerization contribute to the lending function? Increases paperwork, complicated interest charging, facilitates charging interest, monitoring disbursements, delaying inspection of the unit's repayment schedule and delay of loan disbursements. Lending function doesn't make it a delay and less paperwork is there because you have everything in the system itself. It does not complicate it. It rather uncomplicates it because your date of issue and then the closing date of that year is automatically noted. You don't have to note down the opening values. It is directly taken from there. It is basically carried forward. So in this case, the answer is C. Answer is C. Then what has automated clearinghouse functions allowing quicker credit to customers after RTGS introduction? Automated teller machine, check truncation system, traditional check clearing or manual check clearing. What would be the answer according to you, everyone? What would be the answer? You're talking about automated clearing houses allowing quicker to the customer to do RTGS. To have RTGS, the best thing is the check truncation system. You can do the RTGS at any point of time without any problem. So, right, it has taken the place of all the checks and all. People have started following this a lot. This has definitely gained more popularity over the bit of time. The RTGS, NEFT as well as IMPS. But the problem is the monetary differences, right? In terms of RTGS, NEFT and IMPS. There is no other point of, in terms of security, all of these things are now equally secure. Okay, so if you haven't subscribed to our channel yet, please go ahead and subscribe it. If you like this particular class, then please go ahead and like it as well. And download the app right now, because as early as possible, if you download the app, you can accumulate more coins. And if you want to take any of the Mahapacks or any courses, you can definitely lessen your price by working it on your own. No, I'm sorry. Now, let me tell you where to go if you're looking for the courses. Go on to the website, use www.adda247.com, or you can also open up the app. And once you go into this area, click on the area of JIB and CIB. Click on the area of JIB May 2024. This is our Mahapack and this is our resolution batch. In terms of English medium, it includes all four subjects, IE and FS, AFM, RPWM, as well as PPP. Then use the code Y541 and apply it, and you will get a point of 5381.77. And if you are using the code Y541, then you will get 78% if you are doing this through your app. So technically, if you are using these codes, then this can help you out to get maximum discount. And this is for 6 months. You have got around 400 hours of live classes. Then you have around test series, 281 test series is there, and 150 ebooks are available for your studies. That means if you are planning to practice, you can open up the practice books, ebooks. You will find a lot of questions which are given which had come in the examination and all. In the test series, it's all given, and in the ebooks there are certain chapters and everything else. So just review that part now as early as possible and enroll yourself and start preparing right away, because new year has started and the examination is approaching. So it's way better that to start your preparation way before time. Thank you. We'll be meeting.